This is the story of UTair Flight 120. On the 1st of April 2012, UTair Flight 119 was flying from Surgut to Tyumen at 11:41 p.m. local time. Both cities are in Russia, so it was very cold. When the plane landed at Tyumen, it was just 0.2 degrees Celsius above freezing. That's 32 degrees Fahrenheit for the Yanks out there. There was a cyclonic system nearby, and that brought tons of rain and wet, heavy snow. Ironic that a warm cyclonic front would actually cool things down in the long run. But the night was filled with rain and snow and gusts of wind. Not a very pleasant night, if you ask me. But the crew were warm and snug in a hotel nearby, and that's where they stayed till 5:30 a.m. After that, they had to start prepping the plane for Flight 120, all the way back to Surgut. At Tyumen, the flight crew went through a weather briefing as part of their pre-flight prep. The weather was cold, but it wasn't so cold or so rainy that it posed a threat to the safety of the flight, so they saw no reason to cancel the flight. The captain then walked around the plane performing the pre-flight inspection, and the first officer was busy preparing the flight plan. With all of the pre-flight prep done, the crew started the engines. Taxiing was normal, and the ATR-72 lined up with the runway. The pilot saw no reason to cancel the takeoff, so they started the takeoff roll. Flight 120 started to climb. As the plane passed through 600 feet, the pilots engaged the autopilot, and by the time they were at 640 feet, they started to retract the flaps. As they climbed to 690 feet, the plane began to do something that the pilots did not expect. It began to bank to the right. They quickly disengaged the autopilot, but they could not regain control of their plane. The bank to the right worsened with each passing second. The pilots countered it with rudder and aileron inputs, but now they had the opposite problem. The ATR was now banking dangerously to the left. They tried to compensate again with aileron and rudder inputs, but this time they were fighting a losing battle. The pilots could not recover, and the plane went into a dive. Flight 120 slammed into the ground near the village of Gorkovka. There wasn't much left of the plane, but of the 43 people on board, 10 people survived the crash. With the plane all but destroyed, the investigators had their work cut out for them. But they had access to a lot of information to solve this crash. Since the plane had taken off from quite a big airport, most of what the plane did was caught on CCTVs. They even recorded the takeoff. So even before they had access to the CVR and FDR data, they had quite a bit of information to go through. They could see all that the pilots did before the takeoff and how the plane took off. What the investigators were looking for was to see if the pilots adhered to the clean aircraft concept. No, they weren't checking to see if the aircraft was free from dirt and stuff, but from other contaminants like ice, slush, and snow. Even a bit of ice can be incredibly detrimental to an aircraft's performance, as ice changes the shape of the wing, robbing the wing of its ability to generate lift. This is why de-icing is so important. It removes ice and slush from the wing and other controlled surfaces before the plane even takes off. Usually, de-icing is performed by trained ground personnel, but the captain of the plane is the person who's ultimately responsible. He or she must make sure that the plane is free from ice and slush before takeoff. If the conditions warrant it, the pilot can request multiple de-icing sessions. In some airports, pilots often have a quick de-icing session before the plane lines up with the runway to minimize the risk posed by ice. But when they looked at the security footage from the airport, they saw that the captain was inspecting the plane. They then saw the doors close, and they saw the plane being pushed back from its parking spot. They couldn't believe it. This plane had spent the night in the freezing wet cold and had not been de-iced. The wreck of the plane gave them the confirmation that they needed. They could see little ridges of ice on the control surfaces of the plane. Flight 120 was definitely brought down by icing. But they could not understand why two pilots decided to take off without de-icing in a cold Russian winter. At UTair, De-icing was done by ground handlers and other subcontractors. According to the Ground Handling Management Manual, the ground handlers had to learn quite a bit about icing and its effects. The manual goes over things like how different planes are de-iced, the effects ice has on aircraft performance, how to identify ice on aircraft wings, documentation, fluids to be used, all of that important stuff. But all of these materials were taught in very short lectures, and they did not spend enough time on these materials. So basically, the ground handlers at UTair were not qualified to deal with icing issues that Flight 120 was facing. In addition to that, the ground handlers were supposed to undergo recurrent training in de-icing, but after 2010, none of the ground handlers underwent any sort of recurrent training. The ground handlers were not really in a position to ascertain the impact icing would have on aircraft performance. When the plane came in from Surgut the previous day, the technicians carried out a few after-arrival checks and found nothing out of the ordinary. Then, the aircraft was left out in the freezing cold where conditions for icing were perfect. There were strong winds, it was near freezing, the meteorological center sent out warnings about supercooled rain, and UTair's technical operations got the memo. So UTair technics sent personnel out to the plane to assess its situation. They were not qualified enough to assess the state of icing on the plane. When they got to the airplane, they said that the lower portions of the wing was clear of ice, but they never checked the upper surface for icing. Then, the captain showed up and did an external sweep of the aircraft in a half-hearted way. One of the team members from the UTair technical team talked to the pilots, and the pilots told him that they did not want to de-ice the plane and that they were going to take off as is. Big mistake. What the pilots did not know was that the upper surface of the wing and the stabilizer had not been inspected by the technical crew. Had the pilot known that, he might have de-iced the plane. Actually, as per UTair guidelines, the shift head of the ground handling crew who inspected the plane could have de-iced the plane with or without the captain's permission, as the plane had been in icing conditions. But unfortunately, he did not exercise that right and let the plane go without being de-iced. So, the decision to take off without de-icing was taken by a member of the ground crew who had not undergone special training or was qualified to make that call, and by a pilot who did not bother to conduct a proper aircraft inspection. With that, the plane took off. As the plane was a few hundred feet above the ground, the plane started buffeting. The FDR revealed that the plane was trying to lower the nose as Flight 120 creeped towards a stall. Simulation showed that the plane was experiencing a lot more drag than usual due to the ice buildup on the wings and tail. But the question remains, could they have saved the plane? Well, actually, yes. The problem started when the pilots retracted the flaps. At that time, they were at 139 knots. In fact, they should have left the flaps out until they were at 160 knots because they were in icing conditions. But the pilots retracted the flaps way too early. This plane now had too much drag and not enough lift. One fix was to extend the flaps again. They would have been able to save the plane had they re-extended the flaps. But the pilots never did that. This seems reckless on the part of the crew. Why were they making such bad decisions that day? The investigators decided to look into the sleep and rest patterns of the crew to see if they were fatigued. The investigators found out that the pilots did have enough time to rest before the flight, but they had been working a lot in March. The airline had pushed them hard. For example, regulations say that a pilot can only have 2 split shifts in a month, but these pilots had 5 split shifts in March. Looking back at their records, these pilots had unused days off just piling up, so it is entirely possible that when they stepped into the cockpit that day, they had some accumulated fatigue from working so much over the past few months. That accumulated fatigue would definitely color the decisions that they made on that fateful day. In fact, the pilot in command had a psychological test done in 2011, and it clearly showed that he was suffering from accumulated fatigue. This meant that mistakes could creep in. The really sad thing is that the pilot had concerns about icing as he tried to arm the plane's onboard de-icing systems as they taxied. But the onboard de-icing system could only de-ice the leading edges and not the entire wing or stabilizer. In the end, this crash came down to the people involved not de-icing the plane. It should have been obvious, but substandard checks meant that the plane was put into service without the checks that it needed. This meant that ice that would doom the plane went by undetected, just waiting there to bring the plane down. In your opinion, what do you think is the leading cause for this crash? The technicians for not de-icing the plane, the pilots for not requesting a de-icing session, or the airline for working the pilots too hard? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Sometimes ice and snow can bring down a plane even if it's de-iced. That's exactly what happened to Loganair Flight 670 Alpha. If you want to watch that video, the link is on your screen right now. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I will catch you guys next time. Stay safe.